so much. It's a great pleasure to be here. I would like to frame my presentation first based upon some conversations that I've had since I've been at this conference about faculty and oftentimes what appears to be their resistance to technology. And then I'll go in and explain the strengths and weaknesses of different modes of teaching this one course that I developed. I've been teaching for 35 years, and I certainly started out with what is called the sage on the stage, but I found that really boring. And I think what really convinced me not to do that is I was a graduate student in Japan. I lived in Japan for 6 years, and the courses that I hope there's no one that I'm going to offend in the audience. And I was going to probably the most elite university in Tokyo and attending lectures in Japanese, of course. And the instructor would be just reading from his notes, staring down at the notes, reading for the whole class, which would be like an hour and a half. And there were actually students with their heads down asleep while this person was reading from their notes. So I think that really cured me of any desire at all to be this age on the stage. Also, when I was in Tokyo during the early 1980s, and the first Apple store sort of came into Tokyo, and I purchased an Apple II. So I'm one of the early users of that kind of clunky computer at that time. What I wanted to discuss before I go on very quickly, based upon this conversation I've been having with colleagues here, are the barriers to faculty implementation. This has come up in other conversations. Faculty are in general overworked. Their workload is way too much. So to introduce them to a new idea, you have to kind of really sell it well. And this is based on my university experience at Cal State Long Beach. The lack of faculty development in the area of technology. And we had a really excellent director of academic technology, but underfunded. And it was pretty hard to do everything that could be done because of underfunding. Also, half of our faculty at Cal State Long Beach are instructors. They're not in the tenure line. And they're really neglected. They're also the 1,000 faculty who teach GE general education courses. They should really be focusing on training for that level of instructors, which has not happened as it should. So then I go on to the problem with administrators. I know most of our administrators on campus. I was the president of the California Faculty Association, the Teachers Association at Cal State Long Beach for 6 or 7 years. So I got to know most of the administrators. And for the past 3 years I was president, I was lobbying the administrators to spend money on faculty development to introduce technology, more technology, into the campus. So it tends to be, who is your administrator? Are they for technology, not technology? We had a very conservative campus that really didn't adopt technology well because of the lack of administrative vision. But that was changed when our director of technology finally gave our provost an Apple iPad. And that was only several years ago. He had never used any kind of technology, hadn't been teaching for a long period of time. So subsequently, we would never see him anywhere without that iPad. So that was a very successful way to get an administrator on board. Also, if you can get your administrators to offer faculty incentives, like money, to do course design, that has been very effective on our campus. Also, you need to provide faculty with tech support. So, now, first slide. I developed this course, Asian Eats, as a way to seduce students into learning about Asia. And you'll notice on the bottom of the slide, why study Asia? If you go into my portal, you can click and you can see the video there. Typically, the average student at Cal State Long Beach, I'll be lucky if they can identify where China is on a map. You're not taught anything about Asia in the public schools. So this was a way to get freshmen involved in learning about Asia. So what are the learning outcomes that I'm interested in? And I'm going to say that any of the subsequent modalities that I talk about in way of teaching, you can have successful student outcomes if you embed the outcomes into the logic of the course. So it really doesn't matter which style you teach, if you're the sage on the stage, if you use flipped, active, or online. You can have successful student learning outcomes if you design the course to have those outcomes embedded and you test and ensure that the students learn them along the way. However, what does differ from among all of these different modalities is, I'd say, student satisfaction, student engagement. And so let me talk a little bit about that. So rooms do matter. This is a photo that I took of one classroom that I was in, which had no whiteboards. So I had been lobbying for whiteboards in this classroom for 8 months. So I brought in what we used to do in elementary school, you know, the paper. So here you see students on the floor with pieces of paper that they'll then post on the back. I did take this photo. This is a photo I took, and then I sent it to a number of administrators, and I got whiteboards within a week. So, you know, I guess there's a shaming factor to that. But rooms do really matter. Student engagement is much better when you can use the wall space, when students can work in small groups. These are chairs that I think they're about 20 years old. I think they were made in the prison system in the state of California. They don't move around. They're very heavy. It's very difficult, you know, to make those collaborative groups. Nevertheless, we talk about a flipped classroom model where you're doing maybe micro lectures and the students are doing a lot of work against the walls. Those have been very successful because students get really engaged. Here's one of my courses where the students are you know, getting together, collaborating, posting up on the whiteboards what they've learned about the lecture, say the roots of tea here. I can use some micro lectures that I developed for the online course for a flipped classroom as well. So you can start being really creative about mixing things. And also, this provides them, they each have to talk about what they put on the board. So this method, I think, is really good for communication skills. Active learning on the left. This is a picture on the left here of an active learning classroom. Advantages, disadvantages. For Asian EADS, the students really, really got involved in this group work. They liked it. You have to have really good faculty training, however, to be able to use this room in its most effective manner. And so far, our university has not done that. So we have about 10 of these rooms now on a campus of over 300 rooms. They're very hard to get, but yet faculty really haven't been trained to use them to their utmost capacity. You can't, like, lecture very well for long periods of time because the students are in different spaces and oftentimes can't see you that well. This is really a style in which you're walking around mentoring faculty. It's a completely different approach to teaching. One other disadvantage I found from this approach was that the students in groups, they have to do some kind of assessment of each other because they don't always participate. It makes them angry when people in a group don't participate. So you have to have a really, really clear rubric, really clear setup, and I think a contract method where the students sign on that they're going to be doing a certain amount of work. It's all clear to everyone, and their grade is based upon that, seem to solve that problem. I just threw in a synchronous learning experience. This is a Cambodian language class. We have an expert from the University of from Berkeley, UC Berkeley, teaching this class. So it's in a synchronous learning environment. Students from UCLA, UC Berkeley, and Cal State Long Beach are taking this class together. So if you have experts on another campus. You can bring them in this way through a new program that's called Blue Jeans. And very cost effective. So finally, the online course. How has it been effective? What are the challenges? Well, as I mentioned previously, I developed this course to get students involved in Asia at an early level. It's a 100-level course. It's freshman level. However, it has ended up being so popular, whether it's an active learning mode or online mode, that within the first week it's completely enrolled, and it's usually seniors or sophomores who have been enrolled in this course. And I think perhaps that is why that it has been so successful as an online course. I think by the time that you're a senior or a freshman in our system, you know, you're pretty sophisticated. You have good, maybe better, a better skill set in time management, because that is critical. That is really critical in an online course, the kind of student skill set that they bring to the course. I've had difficulty with students actually reading the directions clearly, even though I may give the directions out several different times. So there is a different kind of learning pattern that the students need to bring with them to be successful in an online course. So I think that's it for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Teri.